we know that this linkage between public in, between public capital such as roads, education, or agriculture in general, agriculture R&D specifically, has a link between what we consume and what is available in the market, but there is very little empirical evidence on how these investments in such public capital can influence dietary diversity. So we know that in India, the government actually spends a lot of money on the development of these public capitals. In 2015 and 16 itself, the government of India spent about £230 billion on development of roads, irrigation, education, and agriculture in general. So the motivation behind this project really was to understand better how these, what is the rate of return on public expenditures and investments on dietary diversity, or what is the association between these things. And what we really wanted to find is how nutrition sensitive these public expenditures are in agriculture and otherwise on dietary diversity. A lot of the studies looking at determinants of dietary diversity have been conducted at cross-section level and at like individual or household level. Very little work has been done in a panel setting or at a higher spatial level. So recently we've seen a little bit more work coming which looks at district level information or like state or cross-country level information, but there's not much available in terms of a meso level spatial analysis. And that's the gap that this paper kind is addressing. So what I do is assemble different data sets together, including dietary diversity information using household consumption surveys in India, and they begin from 1919 onwards, and we have about 16 data points from 1990 to 2012. This is combined with other data sets on infrastructure and public investments over a longer period of time between 1970s to 2012. The study is conducted at state level, so I conduct a panel, an assembled panel at state level, or a pseudo panel at state level, and I use a structural equation model, so there's a system of equation here. I'll briefly talk about the conceptual framework, but I don't, again, in the interest of time, don't go into all the seven equations, but I'll focus more on the first equation of the model, which is how I'm modeling dietary diversity at state level. It's a function of crop diversity, agriculture markets, irrigation density, road density, GDP per capita, which is income pathway, essentially, and female education. There's other list of like six equations, which obviously you would I'm not explaining this right now, but broadly what I do is in each of the right-hand side variables, the independent variables have their own equation, and within those equations I have a public investment variable in it. And the key public expenditure variables that I concentrate on in this study are agriculture R&D, so research and development, irrigation spending, expenditure on food storage and warehousing, transport and education. So what do we find in terms of the reduced key equation? We find that crop diversity at state level is positively correlated with dietary diversity score. That is to say that a 1% increase in crop diversity does increase dietary diversity at state level or national level by 0.037. Food groups. So that's a very small marginal impact, but I think it's more or less in line with a lot of other cross-country studies that we've seen across the world. The other positive variables we do find are road density and market density and female literacy rate. What we also find here is very interesting is the irrigation density has a negative impact on dietary diversity. So does the GDP variable. In terms of the more important results of the study, which look at the marginal effect of government expenditures on dietary diversity, we find that actually agriculture research and development have a very strong and positive impact on dietary diversity. So increased spending of ₹100 per capita at 2011 prices increased overall dietary diversity by 0.03 to food groups. Again, a very marginal impact, but I think at a national level, over the time period that we're looking at it, it's an important number. And ranking these public investments, we also find that food storage and warehousing has the second highest impact on dietary diversity. Transport has the third largest effect on dietary diversity, and then education is the last one. Again, like the previous table, we do find irrigation to have a negative effect on dietary diversity, which is an interesting finding because there has been some literature in India specifically talking about how cultivation of pulses has been crowded out and replaced by staple production. So and irrigation in India has usually been very much focused on staple production like wheat and rice in the northern belt, which is one of the richer states in other richer states in India, but however, in my preliminary descriptive analysis in the thesis, I do find that the grain belt in India has lower dietary diversity across in the country. So it's an interesting finding, but it has to be investigated even further because the fact that irrigation potentially could have a negative impact on dietary diversity. So overall, in conclusion, I think the results suggest that there is a renewed case for renewed interest in state expenditures on rural public capital that could potentially increase diversity of production of food crops and therefore link to more better consumption of micronutrient dense food groups. That's it from my side.
Unique way of looking at dietary diversity. And with respect to irrigation density, which is coming out to be negative, I think the data which you have taken from 1970 to 2012, have you also accounted for the green revolution which happened in India and because of which the irrigation density was more in the northern states where mostly high yielding varieties came and then it led to more production or focus on production of wheat and rice rather than other crops, which led to lesser dietary diversity, which might be showing here. So have you controlled for that green revolution?
Yeah, exactly. So as I said, in the secondary equations, there is every independent variable in this key equation has its own like secondary equation. So the pathway from spending on irrigation goes via irrigation density. So the key variable over there is what the density of irrigation would be in like the state. So if in the 1960s a state has much higher irrigation density, that would be part of like this whole system of equations.
And it seems to me, for want of a better term, there's some kind of gentrification of the food environment going on. And I wondered, you mentioned when we talked about it briefly on Monday that it seems to be the government who's driving this in the urban planning policy. But I wondered as well, like, is there any lobbying going on from the private companies and things like that who are owning the supermarkets? And have you managed to touch on that at all?
Yes, definitely. There are processes of gentrification going on. And this is also engaging, actually, also private sector partners, because you can imagine that when a city urbanizes and it widens, also the real estate is becoming more valuable. And so there are a lot of dimensions also going on there. But also the pressure is put from a policy level to the private sector as a kind of responsibility to also ensure food safety. So this is a quite sensitive area. And yes, we have also worked with the private sector who's also trying to do their efforts in this public policy. But the main issue remains that actually the traditional vending is really close to home. It's really well organized in all the different streets, and that is disappearing while a lot of the poor don't have transportation means and don't have the abilities to store at home. That is really hampering, and this is not being considered, not by private sector and not by public sector, especially since private sector packs products, for example, in larger quantities, which is not easy to carry home, for example.
We're expecting the agriculture sector to play a part in making agriculture nutrition sensitive as part of the multi-sectoral interventions. How do we get agriculture to incorporate nutrition into their outcomes that they're responsible for, especially when you say that in most, particularly sub-Saharan African countries, nutrition, rather extension itself, or even for the traditional responsibilities, has not been getting adequate resources. They're already challenged. Now you want to bring this additional responsibility onto their plate. And I've had some personal experience in the project we've been implementing in Ethiopia that we expected agricultural extension to drive our interventions, but eventually we dropped that idea because they just looked too busy and it would not have been effective to do it.
I think one way to go about doing it would be to try and align the interests of the various sectors, and I think a lot of countries, including Ethiopia, are starting to do this, particularly in Ethiopia in the last few years. So it's about bringing people together from the various groups to discuss, hopefully align their interests, at least partially. And I think people tend to be driven by goals, by targets, as do institutions. So I think it's a lot of this is about aligning the goals of the different ministries and making sure that, say, agriculture, for example, has got nutrition-sensitive targets that it's working towards. Other than that, also things like developing capacity around nutrition and sensitising to people in non-health sectors to the importance of nutrition. And then, a bit more challenging, but would be to try and produce nutrition-relevant data in non-health sectors as well.
There's two strange results on per capita expenditure and irrigation. You try to explain on the irrigation, but not on the per capita and why. And then relatedly, the explanation that you gave was possibly because farmers are now using irrigation, that they're producing only cereals instead of pulses. But this production decision is also dependent upon the profitability of the new crop, that is cereals. That would mean that they are having more income. Having more income means they can go to the market and then purchase diversified foods.
Understand better, investigate this better in future research. But I also look at the same model with and change the outcome variable to specific food groups, so share of food groups in the country. And what I find is basically that all the staple and starchy food groups like tubers and roots also have a negative relationship between general public investments, but with irrigation they have a positive relationship. All the other food groups such as fruit and veg, meat and meat products, dairy, all of those have a negative relationship with agriculture irrigation expenditure. Now, I can't remember which ones of them were significant or not, but clearly there was a sign change in a direction of association. So definitely the income pathway in terms of expenditure on rice and wheat and all the staples was key in India. So Green Revolution was key to reduce hunger in India. But going further and looking at the challenges of malnutrition in India at the moment, which are to do with micronutrient deficiencies, not just in children under 5, but also in adults. India has the highest burden of, one of the highest burdens of adult malnutrition and micronutrient deficiencies, specifically in women. Looking at the challenge of improving consumption of micronutrient-dense food groups or protein, for example, I think investments in other public capitals also is quite important. Not to say that irrigation needs to be reduced, but to suggest that there should be more investment in other public capitals.
Thanks to today's presenter who traveled far and near to share their experience to engage each other. Thank you all.